Good afternoon, everybody. The final session in this conference. After this session, we only have one session left, but this is not about content. So I hope you enjoyed so far, and I hope I can add something to your experience until now. My name is Arend-Jan Koofman. I'm from the Netherlands, working with a company called Expert Group. And I'm Microsoft Dynamics MVP since last year. And I'm also one of the founders of the Dutch Dynamics community, a community in the Netherlands who organizes four or five times per year a session evening, and about 150 to 200 people are attending each time. I have a blog on the internet, and if you feel that you need to contact me, here are some contact details. What I'm going to talk about in this session is about Office 365 integration. And I have four topics. I want to spend some words about Office 365 single sign-on. You have seen this yesterday in the keynote that Thomas Helsberg tried to configure it, but he failed. So I want to spend some words about Office 365 single sign-on and explain why it is possible to use Office 365. Then I want to show you how to link to the web client from SharePoint, to place a link in SharePoint that links to the web client without having you to sign in again. The next part is embed web client in SharePoint, which is a different thing. So you can build portals in SharePoint using parts of the web client. And if time permits, then I'll show you how to export to Office 365 from Dynamics NEV, because there is a code unit available in Dynamics NEV that you can use and reuse to export your own files. But first, I have a question. The question is, why should we integrate with SharePoint? The point is, Microsoft tells us, if we want to demonstrate Dynamics NEV, to use SharePoint as a starting point. Not use the Windows client or the web client, but to go with SharePoint as the first demonstration. And I wondered why. So I keep thinking about it, and I think I now know why it is. Not because it is possible, but because SharePoint is about information. SharePoint and Office comes from the information worker department in Microsoft, and that is about information. While the Windows client in our ERP solution, Dynamics NEV, is about entering data. But for the users, is the data not important? For the user, it is important to get information out of it. Information with a context. So SharePoint makes sense, because SharePoint can be used to combine data, to have a context in the data, and to have it available in multiple places. So this is why Microsoft tells us to use SharePoint. How many people from you did attend yesterday the lab about Office 365? A few, great. A few did not. But I have a next question. From you, who did attend the lab yesterday, did you fully understand what you were doing? No. Okay, great. I'm asking that because you had a large script, document, and you had to do things with SharePoint and with Visual Studio, but probably you didn't have a clue what you were doing. You were just following a script. What I'm trying to do in this session is to explain why you are doing it. So for those persons who did the lab yesterday, they will see the same parts, because it's not a different story. I will going to do this online, but now I hopefully you will understand afterwards why you are doing it. And if not, please tell me, because then I did not a correct session. Office 365 single sign-on. I'm not going to configure it. I have configured it already, because I don't want to have it filled in this session, so I'm sure I have already set it up. But as you can see here on the user card, there is an Office 365 authentication tab. And now listen carefully. This Office 365 authentication tab is lying to you. It is not Office 365 authentication. In fact, this is about Azure Active Directory, which is not Office 365. But why is Microsoft calling it here Office 365 authentication? Because the Azure Active Directory on itself is for free. They don't earn money from Azure Active Directory. If you're using Azure Active Directory, you don't earn money. But it doesn't have any added value. Office 365 is a product has an added value. And, well, maybe they try to sell Office 365 in this way. And I can imagine that. But the thing is, technically spoken, and you are techies, of course, because you are here, this is not Office 365, this is Azure. And the picture is as follows. The Azure Active Directory is in the middle. And Dynamics 9 and Office 365 are at exactly the same level. Every Office 365 user is, in the background, an Azure Active Directory user. As soon as you create an Office 365 tenant, immediately you will get a Microsoft Azure tenant, without further notice. You cannot log in into that Microsoft Azure tenant because you don't have a password for it. And if you want to enter it, you need to have a subscription or at least enter your credit card details. But without further notice, you do have an Azure Active Directory because Office 365 does not store the users in its own personal directory or in its own Office 365 directory. It stores the users in Azure Active Directory. And because Dynamics NIV is capable of using Azure Active Directory as the source to authenticate users against, then it becomes possible to use Office 365 users to get authenticated against Dynamics NAV. But if you leave out Office 365, then it's still perfectly possible to create users in Azure Active Directory and to use these users with Dynamics NIV. So this is a different story probably. You probably didn't know, but now you do. You see also here the on-premise part here, the on-premise Active Directory. This one can play a part. This can play a role in the whole story because it is possible to synchronize the users from Active Directory on-premise to the Azure Active Directory. And then Office 365 will recognize that the Azure Active Directory is being synchronized by the on-premise Active Directory. And then it's not possible to add new users in Office 365 directly. You have to add them in your on-premise Active Directory, then synchronize them. This can be done automatically, each hour or whatever you want. And after these have been added and synchronized to the Azure Active Directory, you can use them in Office 365, you can use them in Dynamics NAV, or in any other application like Azure RMS or another ISV application or whatever application that is using Azure Active Directory authentication. So these are a few words about Office 365 single sign-on and why it is possible. I've already set up the complete environment, so I'm not going to show you. Final word about it. Yesterday you saw that Thomas Helsberg was trying it to do the hard way, trying to configure all the parts in Azure and in the web config file and in the customer settings file, etc. There is a script available on the DVD. I think it's available from 2013 R2 cumulative update 10 or 9, I'm not sure, 10 or 9, I think it was 10. And this script is doing all the hard stuff for you. You even don't need an Azure Active Directory subscription, because it is already available with your Office 365 user, and with this user you can do some modifications to the Azure Active Directory without logging into the portal, the Azure portal. So the script will take the username password that is the administrator of Office 365 and modify in the background the Azure Active Directory for single sign-on for you. The only thing that you need to do afterwards is configuring the client user settings config file of the Dynamics NAV Windows client, and you get a link in the output what to put there. So it's easy. All right. About the SharePoint integration. What do we need? SharePoint integration first needs to have Office 365 single sign-on enabled. Well, this part has been covered by now. The next step that we need to do is on SharePoint create an app catalog. And this is different from the lab. In the lab, registering an app was the first step. And then you get to the next step was to create an app catalog and then create the app in Visual Studio. But create an app catalog on SharePoint must be done one time. And then you register an app and then you create the app with Visual Studio. So I can skip this one, SharePoint app catalog. The SharePoint app catalog offers you the possibility to create apps that you deploy to your own SharePoint online tenant. It is different from the public app catalog. If you want to publish apps to the public app catalog, then you have to sign up with Microsoft to be able to publish apps to a catalog that everybody in the world can buy from you. But there's also a possibility to have your own private app catalog, and this own private app catalog is created once at your SharePoint site. You can only have one, and this can be used for internal development before you publish your app to the public app catalog, or you can use it for your company deployment, just to deploy only apps to your own site. The creation of the app catalog takes a few minutes, and then you are ready. So this is the first step that I want to do and want to show to you. So we go step by step through the complete process. So the first step is we go going to create an app catalog. And I'm doing it right now because it takes a few minutes to finish. So I'm going to my SharePoint site. It is a complete empty site. I have nothing in here. Nothing here. I guess it's now here. There we go. Thank you. Logging into my Azure, to my Office 365 site, the SharePoint online, and this one is empty. Just created, nothing has been done. Well, I've of course done it before, but I've removed all the items. So the first step that we need to do is create an app catalog, and we're going to do this in the admin SharePoint site. In the app SharePoint site, we have a number of collections, and we have to add here a new collection called the app catalog collection. And there's a simple way to do that. To do this, we go to the apps, app catalog, and then it recognizes that there is no app catalog available. So we just go and create a new app catalog. So this app catalog is created on this site, and it can contain apps that can be added by the users on their pages, on the portals, and this app catalog is local to your SharePoint site. So we give this app catalog a name. I call this the Kronos app, Kronos company app catalog, and it is in the website address. Well, let's name take app catalog. We give it the correct time zone, just to be sure. The administrator will be myself. We have to specify some quota, storage quota, which means how many space this app catalog can take, and this should do the trick. Validate it. Do we have any response? We do. And now we get back to the site collections. And as you can see here, there's an icon. And after a few minutes, it will become an icon new. So we let this thing running in the background and go back to slides. So now we have created the app catalog where we can store the apps that we are now going to create. The first step to create an app in SharePoint is to register the app in SharePoint. Because before being able to have an app in SharePoint, we need first to tell SharePoint what app there will be available. Then we get a client ID back from SharePoint, and this client ID can be used in our app that we are going to create in Visual Studio. Because otherwise, you could create an app by yourself without, if you had not this registering part, you could create any app and upload it, and it will be unknown by SharePoint, and it would become kind of vulnerable, of course. So the first thing we need to do is get a client ID to identify the app. And then we're going to use this client ID in the app manifest file, and you will see that later on. So the first step is to create or to register an app in SharePoint. I have to switch again. It's still running here. To create the app, to register the app, normally on the public app catalog that is available outside your own SharePoint for the public world, there's a link to register apps. But in this site, there is no direct link to register a new app. So there is a URL that we need to use, and it is called layouts, and it is of course something. It's this one, app rec new. This is a link that you should use to register a new app. It is no link to this in SharePoint. You need to know about this URL to use it. In this page, we are going to specify the app. Let's take a title. We just call it Microsoft Dynamics Nav 2015. Oh no, this is the wrong thing. We have to generate. We're going to generate a client ID here. We generate a client secret, and here we have the title. In the app domain, we have to specify the name, the URL of the web client, because our app is going to be hosted on the web client. It is a thing that an app that goes outside SharePoint. So the basic URL of the app domain, is our web client URL. In this case, I have the web URL at ltajkkronos.company. My web client is running there. And the redirect URL is the complete URL. Is cronus.company. Well, I'm going to copy it. Is this site? Oh, too late. I'm going to log in into the web client so you can see that it will work. As you can see here, I didn't log in. This is not about Windows login, because I was already logged in into SharePoint. And now the web client recognizes this, so immediately returns to the web client itself. I'm going to create the app information, and there's one thing that I need to copy here, and this is the client ID, because I need the client ID when I'm going to create the app with Visual Studio. So put it here for later usage. Just to prove that this one is working with Office 365 single sign-on, I open an in-private session and open the web client again. And now you see the Office 365 login. Entering the password, username and password, and then we log in. So Office 365 single sign-on is working on this site. All right, so the first step was to create or to register the app in SharePoint. We get a client ID back, and now we are ready to create the app in Visual Studio. Let's have a look at SharePoint app catalog. Hopefully it has been created right now. And as you can see here, we have a new sign. So the app catalog is available. Nice. So the next step, this one, is to create and publish the SharePoint app. This is done by Visual Studio. In Visual Studio, we need to create a new project, type of a SharePoint, app for SharePoint. And then we are going to create a new project that is provider hosted. You will see it in a minute where we set this up. Provider hosted is a thing that you should understand, because there are two different models. You can create a SharePoint app that is hosted on SharePoint itself, and you can create a SharePoint app that is hosted outside SharePoint. In this case, we are creating a web, an app that is hosted by the web client, so it is hosted outside your SharePoint, and this is called provider hosted. The next thing that we're going to do after the web client has been created, or the application project has been created, is remove a complete website from the project. This is because if you create a SharePoint app, it already creates for you the website. A kind of website template. But we are not going to create a website. The website already has been created. The website that has been created is the website, the NAV web client itself. And we're only going to link to the web client. Well, let's go to Visual Studio and show that. I'm opening Visual Studio. And we choose to create a new project. And we go to Visual C Sharp, Office SharePoint, Apps, App for SharePoint. And let's call this thing NAV 2015 for NAV Tech Days. Press OK. The first thing he asks is, what SharePoint site do you want to use for debugging your app? We don't have one. So we just accept the normal of the dummy that's here, no host. The second one is, how do you want to host your app for SharePoint? Provider hosted or SharePoint hosted? And at this point, we take the provider hosted, because the web client is not on SharePoint itself, it's on my local machine here. So this means that SharePoint, which is sitting outside somewhere else, and my local web client, which is here on my computer, will be linked together. So this is provider hosted. Provider is means my laptop in this case. We click finish, because if we go for the next button, then we have optional settings, but these optional settings we don't care about. Then we get an error message But this is because it says, I cannot connect to the SharePoint site. Well, it was a dummy site, of course. So we accept the error message, and it will continue creating the project. As I said, the project is created by using a template. As you can see here, to the left, we have a complete web. It's also called the web, which is a template for a SharePoint website. Because Visual Studio doesn't know that we already have a website in place. So for this reason, it creates by default a website that is capable of being hosted in SharePoint. We already have the website available, so we just go to this website and say delete or remove. Save changes before, yes please. So this will leave us with just two files. An icon file, I'm not going to change that one. And we have an app manifest XML. And the app manifest XML is the one that we need to modify. In this file, we have to modify at least two things, or maybe we want to change also the title. For this moment, I'm not going to change the title, it's already there. We need to change the start page. The start page is the site that we are pointing to. So this is the link to our nav web client. So as a start page, I'm only going to take this part to change. So I leave the standard tokens here, because these come from SharePoint itself, and I only change the first part. And the first part is again this part, the website URL. Put it in here. The second thing that we need to change is the client ID. This is the client ID that we have copied while we registered the app on SharePoint. That's it. Now we save this. And the next step is publish this app. Right click on the project, choose publish. And now we have two options. We can package it. And we can go to the seller dashboard. The seller dashboard is for sell your app on the public app store. But we're not going to do this, of course. Only packaging the app, and we will upload it to our own store. So now I have an app file here. This app file must be uploaded to the app catalog that we created before. So now we go back to the app catalog. Apps, app catalog. The previous time we clicked here, we got a message that there was no app catalog available, and we created one. Now it says, okay, there is one created, one available, and it opens the Kronos company app catalog. We go to apps for SharePoint. It's also possible to create here apps for Office. If you do that and you create an app for Office and add it to this catalog, then it becomes possible to add an app to your on-premise Word or Excel installation. Because also there in the ribbon bar there's an Add App button, and this app button, if it's connected to Office 365, of course, can take apps from the local app catalog from your Office 365 installation, just as a side note. Well, it is pretty easy to deploy this one to the app catalog. It's just drag and drop. And now has been uploaded to the site, and it's available. This does not mean that this app can now be used directly. It is only available in the app catalog. As a next step, we need to add this app to a page. We need to add this app to the SharePoint site itself, because there can be many apps in this app catalog, and there are many apps in the public catalog as well. But as you can imagine, if you have an app in the public catalog, they don't become available by default on your website. So the only thing that we have done now is put something into the store, into the app catalog store. And now it is possible to take an app from the app catalog to add it to the site. So this is the next step we were going to do. We go back to the site, the team site, and here on this page we go to the site contents. The site contents is a site that contains all kind of apps and you could say assets that can be added or are added to your site. In this case we go to add an app, and you can see it is already available here. Here we are on the site apps you can add. There are 16 pages of possible apps. They all come from the public app catalog. And if you want to view in our own app catalog, we click on from your organization. And now the total list is filtered by only the apps that are available in the app catalog that we created before. We click on this one to add it. We say trust it. And it is now being added. It says for a few seconds over here, we are adding your app. This takes a few seconds and then it will become available. And after it is available, which is now, we can click on it to use it. And now we are in our Office 365, or in our web client. So go back, just close everything and go back to the site, because I was all logged in already on both pages, on the web client and SharePoint. So now I'm going to log in again, only on Office 365. And now we already have this link over here in our recent links. I click on it, and it immediately goes to the URL that we created before. I was hoping for one thing, but it does not happen. It happened yesterday, but okay. Sometimes, and sometimes not, over here in the top, it says Microsoft Dynamics NAV for Office 365. I don't know why it's not displaying here. I asked yesterday Microsoft people, do you know when this thing is coming, and they start playing around with some parameters in the URL, and at the end we took off all the URLs and it was still displaying, of all the parameters and it was still displaying that. So probably something to do with cookies or whatever, I don't know. So this is the first link that we can do. What can we do with this app? It's now added to our site, and we can add it as a link to SharePoint. Well, we already did this, but you can see here, it is in this recent link. According to the documentation, it should be possible to go to site contents, and then say edit links, and then take this one. You can see that the cursor is changing here, and then drop it. How many times I try this, it doesn't work. But officially this should work. Maybe it's because of my Internet Explorer version, not compatible with the SharePoint, I don't know. But officially, what you should do is take this one and drag it and drop it on this menu. So what we have done now, so far, is created an app, and we have added this app to SharePoint, which makes it available, possible for us to link from SharePoint to the web client. That's all. The next step that we're going to do, which is much more, nice to do, is to embed the web pages from NIV to SharePoint. Because then we can build up a portal that takes part of the web client to show on the portal page. So let's do that, starting from scratch. Well, we take this one as a starting point, of course, but I have nothing in place right now. I'm not going to copy things, I'm just going to create it. A few words before. We are going to add a new part to the just created project in Visual Studio. We are going to add a new web part. This web part will link to a page, a particular page of the web client. This is possible because the web client takes a parameter with page ID. So if we open the web client with a page ID, we can just jump directly to a certain page. So let me demonstrate this, because the app is going to use this. Let's open the web client, and I'm going to jump to list ASPX, page is 22. And now we get the customer list directly as a link. But as you can see here, this page contains a lot of information around the list. I asked for a list, but what I get is a list with a ribbon bar, with navigation, with fact boxes. And there are a few parameters that we can add to the URL to get rid of these parts. And I have listed these parameters over here. We can say show UI parts is zero. So let's see if I can open this one again. Page is 22 and show UI parts is zero. You see what happened? The fact boxes disappeared. This is one parameter that we need. Because if we have the fact boxes and the navigation and ribbon bar and all the same, all these things in SharePoint, it will completely fill up our SharePoint page. We only want to grab the list page itself. That's the reason why we do this. So this is the first thing. The next thing that we're going to do is add a new one, which says, let me see, show navigation is zero. And now the navigation menu, the left side, has gone. So we can tweak this. Well, you can, of course, imagine what the next thing will be. We say show ribbon is zero. There we go. So now we have removed all the parts. The next thing that we want to control is how many records are displayed in this page. Because otherwise we don't control how much space this part will take in our SharePoint site. Well, there's a parameter for that, which is called, I have not put it here. This parameter is called, let me think. I'm not sure. I have put it here, but it is gone. So you are part. No, I'm not sure. I have to look at the things that are here. Page size, that was it. Page size equals, let's say, 15. Well, obviously, we had already 15. So let's take page size is 5. Now we only have 5 records. But it's still occupying space for the rest of the list of the list that could be in place. So the final part that we are going to add is tell this page that it is embedded. We add the new thing is embedded is 1. Add 5 and is embedded is 1. And now we have a page that only takes up the space that it needs and not more. So these parameters can be added to the web client, and we're going to use all these parameters to embed this in SharePoint. So now the page knows it is embedded. The page knows that it does not have to show all the stuff around it and only displays the data that you want to display. And we can do the same with other pages as well, of course. This is page 22, but we can go for page, let's take this one. And we're going, of course, going to add this one to SharePoint as well, because now this makes sense. If we can add a generic chart to SharePoint, then it becomes possible to build up a portal that not only contains data, but also contains some visualization of your data, so give you some information. So how does this work with our Visual Studio app? The first thing that we need to do before, we can do it afterwards, but I'm now here on this page. If we are going to change the app, what we are going to do now, we are adding a new part to the app. If we want to utilize this on the site, we need to remove the previous created app from the site. This app has already been installed on the site, so the first thing that we need to do is to remove this. It's remove, and that's it. We are removing your app. We go back to Visual Studio, and we are going to add a new item. The new item is a client web part. This client web part will host the web URL that we just composed, page 22, with all these parameters. So we call this web part the NIV customer list. We add this web part, and now we have two options. Create a new app web page. It basically means that it tries to add a web page to the website that is linked to this app, or select a URL of an existing web page. And this is, of course, what we are going to do now. So let's go back to this URL, because we just built this one. Copy. Paste it here. We click on finish. And here we are. We can change the title. The nav customer list title. Because this title will become visible in the SharePoint app catalog. And now I know on beforehand that we will get some errors. So don't be scared. I'm prepared for that. I warned you. So we're going to do exactly the same steps. We publish, we package the app, and here we have the app again. we go back to the site administration. What is going to leave? Yes, I want to leave this page. Why not? We go to the app catalog and then to apps for SharePoint, and we upload this file again. Now it tells us that a file with this name already exists, and we say yes, we want to replace it. That's all. Now we can reuse this on our page. So we go back to, I want to click on sites. Can we have our site, please? Kronoscompany.sharepoint.com. Now we are back on our site. We go to site contents. We click on add an app from your organization. We click on the app and we say trust it. And this is the first error. Something went wrong. The reason that we get this error message, well, to be honest, I don't know. Somewhere in the cache for SharePoint site, it has still cached this this app. So unless that we unloaded it, uninstalled it, removed it from the site, somewhere it has still been loaded. So the thing is, we cannot an app that is already in memory on the SharePoint site. So if you get this error, there's just one simple thing that you need to do. We go back to the site, of course, because it's the only option. And we need to go to our SharePoint or to our Visual Studio. We open the app manifest file, already open it here. And we increase the version number. That's all. Then SharePoint will recognize there is a new version enabled, there's a new version for you, and it will replace it on the site. So we say publish, package the app, and now you can see here this is the new version. We go back to the app catalog, which is in the in your admin page, apps for SharePoint. We upload it. We say yes, there is one with the same name. Replace it. And now we can go back to the sites, the team site, site contents, add a new app, the one that we just added, the updated app. We say trust it. And now it's being added. So first error solved. I expect a next error. Just to warn you, I'm not scared. I expect errors all over all the place. So the next error that we will get is an error that we cannot do embed this page in SharePoint. Because this page, the web client page, is coming from a totally different domain than our SharePoint site is running on. And basically, what we have done with the web part is we have a provider-hosted web part that will run in an iframe. And an iframe on HTML is a kind of, you could say, a window in your page that has an own URL. So you could say a browser in a browser, picture in picture, that kind of stuff. And the iframe, this is an HTML part that contains data and scripts from a different domain than the domain that you are visiting, can use some cross-site scripting, because it can you can have some kind of scripting so that you can access the hosting site from your iframe, and then it would become possible to have some script that accesses the hosting site from the iframe site. So two sites that should not see each other can see each other when you're using the iframe. And this is by default considered as not safe. And the web client from the Nav web client does not accept this by default. So I'm first going to show this error, and then we're going to fix it. So we have added this app. We still have this one here. We still can use it, prove it. But now we have also a web part. We're going to add this web part to the page. We say edit, insert a web part. And now in the list here, we have the Nav customer list. We click on add, and we already see the error. Just click on save. And here we have the error. This content cannot be displayed in a frame. So what the case is here, that this part of the site has a different URL. Here we are looking at kronoscompany.sharepoint.com, but this part comes from lt-ajk.kronos.company, a totally different domain running on my laptop. And this is considered unsafe. So what we are going to do now is to tell the web client that it is safe to be hosted in a frame. And this is a setting that can be done in the webconfig of the webconfig file of the Nav web client. So we go to the Nav web client. I go to inetpub, this is where the site is hosted. And here we have the first webconfig file. Don't change this file, because this webconfig file is containing all the settings for the Nav server. This file contains the settings which Nav server it should contact. We must go one level further, and here we have a webconfig file that we need to change. This is the webconfig file from the site itself. I cannot open it and change it and save it, because you need administrator access to this folder, and well, I don't have administrator access right now. So what I'm going to do is start Visual Studio and run it as an administrator. And then I'm going to open the file. I have done it before, so I'm immediately in the correct place here. I open the webconfig. And in this file, we are looking for a particular place. Just search for frame, or it's called X-frame. In the X-frame options, it says same origin. It means that this can only be run as embedded when you are in exactly the same hosting site with the same starting URL, the same domain. There is some explanation here, allows framing of the web client in another website only if the other website is on the same host. Remove this to enable cross-site framing, but be aware of the increased risk of clickjacking. So, a disclaimer from Microsoft, so you can never blame them. We're just going to comment this line. I press on save, minimize this one, and press F5 to refresh. The next thing that I had expected before was an error message that it is not possible to do a confirm. But now I'm using Nav 2015, and I don't know if you already have installed Nav 2015, but in Nav 2015 the Kronos message has been removed. If you're doing this on Nav 2013 R2, the next thing you will get right now is an error message that it is not possible in an embedded page to show a confirmation dialog, the Kronos dialog that tells you that you are in a demonstration environment. So if you get that message on 2013R2, you should go into code unit 40 and disable the Cronus dialog box. But in 2015, there is no Cronus dialog anymore. You just start it. You can see it here. I'll prove that it is not there. I've not changed code unit 40. We just start the Windows client. As you can see, this one is also starting up with the single sign-on. So I use my credentials here, and this will start the Windows client without the Cronus message. But it is still Cronus. This is a default installation. I've only added some code units, but not changed any code unit. So if you have 2013R2, you will get a message here. Now we see that this page part is not aligning very well. It's not resizing. And this is because in the default web part that we added in Visual Studio, there is a sizing tag. It is here in the top, default width, default height. If we need more space, we need to change this default width and default height to occupy more space by default on the site. There is a different possibility. I'm going to show you now. We can change the page. Go to Edit. Click this one. Click on Web Part Properties. And here we can say, I want to have it a fixed height. So let's give it a height of 500 and a fixed width, let's say 1000. Apply. And now we have more space available. Press OK. We do save. Let's get, by the way, rid of this get started with your site. So now we have the customer list embedded on SharePoint. It's only 5 lines, because 5 lines was specified in the URL that we had here. Well, that was also sneaky when I copied the URL, complete company and bookmark. We should remove this one. As you can see here, we have the page size 5. So for this reason, it only shows 5 lines of customers. And we can use this button to browse to the next page. And then, of course, the question is, can we click on a customer? What happens then? Well, let's do that. You will get a pop-up of the customer card. But now notice the URL on top. This URL is now from my web client domain, not a SharePoint domain. So it jumps out of the embedded page part. It goes to the web client, pops up the card to show you. We can now edit things, but there's another topic, of course, how to edit things in the web client. I'm just going to close this one, and now we are redirected to the site. Hey, again with the get started with your site. I thought we removed that one. Anyway, so this is how it interacts. So it's not only showing you the list, it's also possible to show you the card. All right. 30 minutes left. So let's add some more parts to show you what's possible and to add the site, the width and height, etc. So what we're going to do now is go back to the Visual Studio. Just click on add a new item, and we add a new client web part, and let's add one of the graphics. I want to add the mini generic card. I don't know the name by heart, so let's have a look. It is page number 1390, 1390, 1390. I want to show first how this looks like in the browser. If you do this with page 1390, this is this chart that we're going to embed now on SharePoint. So I copied this URL, so we have kind of pre-configured it, and we say this is the mini, what was it called? Mini generic chart. But you can take any name, of course. It has a new existing URL. We paste it in here, we say finish, and the only thing we're going to change is the title. We say publish, package the app, and now we made the same mistake. You had a question? Exactly. I have 5 t-shirts to give away, but you got already one. Because this was indeed the error, the mistake. I had to change the version before. So at least one person is paying attention. We go back to the app manifest file, we change the version, we press save, and going to publish and package the app again. We go back to the site, and now we're going to remove the app. Do we need to remove the web parts from the page before we remove the app? And the answer is no, we don't. I just go to the apps, as remove, and now they are removing the app. And the work that's being done now is that it's removed from all the pages and links that is using this app. So if we go back to home, it is gone. So now we go back to the app catalog to upload the new version. Apps, app catalog, working on it, that's very nice. Apps for SharePoint. Upload, so replace, you go back to the sites, site contents, now we can add the app again from our app catalog, and else being added again with a new list part in it. So now we have 2 list parts. We edit the page. So insert a web part, and here we have the mini generic chart. We add this one. Well, forgot to set the width and height. Well, let's see that this can be done by Visual Studio itself. So I'm not going to save this. Well, it did save now. We'll go back to site contents. Remove the app. I'm not sure how many space this thing needs, so we just pick one. This is the generic chart. I recognize this because there's a mini generic chart here. We say default width is, let's say, 600, and default height is, maybe default height should be 600 and default it should be 800, somewhat. Now I don't forget the version number. We don't get a new t-shirt. We publish it again. Oh, this is the wrong one. We go back to the app catalog. And upload it again. Version 3. Replace this one. Go back to the sites. Edit the page. Insert it as a web part. Oh, what did I forgot? Add the application, exactly. Stop editing. We go to site contents. We first need to add this one. Trust it. It's being added. So now you've seen it many times, so I hope you can do it yourself tomorrow. Oh, tomorrow is Saturday, but next week. It doesn't work on Saturday. Anyway, we edit this page. Insert. Well, come on, insert the web part, and there we have the generic chart again. We press on loading, and there he is. Nicely sized. Save. There we are. As you can imagine, if we add multiple parts of this in this way, we can build up a complete portal. I'm now only adding this to the home page. We can easily add a new site to SharePoint, for example, a financial site, a sales order site, or whatever kind of site you want to add, and then add particular parts on that site using this type of web parts. So I wanted to talk about 90 minutes about it. Obviously, this is not going to happen, because this is all. It's that easy, isn't it? The question is, if it is possible to add parameters to the generic web part, and the answer is I don't know. Probably yes, probably I don't know. I haven't figured that out. The thing is that the generic web, the generic chart is a rather complex page enough because it's leading from the generic charts and etc. So I'm not sure if you can add a parameter to it. I don't know. No, that's not possible. The question is if it's possible to add a parameter in, if I translate it correctly, in this part, in this URL, so you can have this one, the page number dynamic, and probably also the width and height dynamic. And the answer is no, that's not possible. As far as I know, I tried to figure it out before because I had the same question. The thing is, as soon as you publish the app in Visual Studio, the app is being kind of built. It's built by a template. And the only thing that is possible is instead of adding here the complete URL, there is a kind of template URL. It starts with the... This character, where is it? This character, and then a keyword, but that keyword then again is being replaced by the template that is used for the build of the package. So the only thing that you could do is when packaging this app, that you then in all web parts replace automatically, done by the build template, the URL. Instead of having a fixed URL in this this web part. But what's not possible is that you create an app and it dynamically knows from by magically knows which URL should be used for the web client. So you have to create an app per SharePoint site that combines with just one web client. That's the status of today. Maybe it will be possible next week or in a few months, I don't know. But for now, it's this. It's a good question anyway, but you already had a shirt. I'm, of course, ready to take some questions, and I can show you how to export from CAL code to SharePoint, because that's also part of the integration between Ev and SharePoint. But let's first take some questions. So can I have the mic, lady, for some questions? Thank you. I can't hear the question.
Where is that?
My question is, which type of pages can we add as a web part? Like, can we add card, worksheet, and repeater?
We can add list pages. Okay, we can try to add cards. I haven't tried it because, in my view, it didn't make any sense to add a card page, but I guess it's possible. We can add the role centers as a complete role center. We can also take the activities page. So it's possible to have all the tiles in SharePoint.
Okay.
That's possible. I can show that in a second. There's no problem.
Because we removed the, you know, those parts, isn't it, from the site. I thought we can add only the single level.
Then you only have this. Single We can try if that's possible.
Okay.
After the questions, there are a few questions here, so it's coming down, she's coming down, of course, but she's first going up.
I have a question about these comments we see, because as I see the comment below, we can define some properties and put in the content as underlined before and at the end of the property. So probably we can use these properties, for example, to make generic web part for putting on SharePoint any page we want using one control.
I'll be honest, I'm not getting the question totally. So
if we see these comments on the screen, yes?
These comments, yes?
We can use properties to set to change the URL itself.
Yeah, but this is, or here's the app web URL what I talk about.
For example, it's just company page number or
yeah,
something.
But these are only used in the build template. So this app web URL is replaced by a fixed content when building the app.
Okay, so this is not runtime.
So this is not dynamically done when hosted in the site itself.
Mm-hmm.
And that's because if it's in the site, it doesn't have any configuration that it knows where it comes from, where it should target to. It does not contain a settings file or something. It's just replaced by the build template. So, I'm sorry.
Okay. Hi. Is it possible to automatically publish the site to SharePoint without doing the manual actions of trusting it and adding it, replacing it?
Well, that's a very good question. You receive a t-shirt for that one, because it is possible. It is possible, and it's possible using PowerShell commandlets. I don't have them here in place, but there is a SharePoint script, of a PowerShell script, that was created by Freddy Christiansen as an example, that is capable of creating a complete site with apps embedded on it that combines different charts and lists, etc. So fully automated publication of the apps. But they had to do some tweaking in it. They had to bypass some SharePoint shortcomings. So it's for that reason it's not publicly available. But I trust that it will become available as soon as SharePoint fully supports these kind of PowerShell scripts. So this is, well, it is possible today with some hard work to do. And I expect that it will become more automatically available in the future. This is evolving. I've seen it many times in the past, of course, that when the first time you think, okay, what do I have to do? And then the next version you had some automation, then the next version you had more automation, and the final version, after a year or after 2 years, you have forgotten what you had to do about all these parts. Remember the 2009 version and 2013 version with all the SPNs, for example, in environment. Well, this is exactly the same story.
Okay, hello. I have one note and one question.
Yes.
The question is, the NAV is on premise. Isn't it?
The NAV is what?
Is on premise.
On premise.
On premise environment.
Yeah. Because
what happened when the internet broke up, and you can log in with O365 account?
That's perfectly possible, because I've just shown you we have an on-premise environment of NAV. Mm-hmm. So it is no problem to have NAV on-premise. Well, that was the question, wasn't it?
I am also on-premise, and the server is on-premise, and
oh,
our internet broke up, and
the SharePoint on-premise, you mean?
No,
okay, but then I don't understand the question.
Okay, it was a stupid question.
What I understood from your question is you're asking if it's possible to have NAV on-premise to do this.
Yeah.
And yes, the answer is yes, that is possible, mm-hmm. because you just showed it. I just showed it to you. Just viewed at an on-premise NAV environment. Because it was installed locally on my laptop. So it can be on your machine, it can
but
be on a virtual machine, in your on-premise network, whatever.
Normally you have your NAV installed on-premise in your environment.
Mm-hmm.
And the users can authenticate through Azure Active Directory.
Yes, that's possible.
What happens to users when the link breaks? They can't authenticate to O365. Can they log in to NAV?
Yes, that should be possible, because the NAV server, when it's configured for Office 365, can still take username password.
Mm-hmm.
The
so
NAV username password.
Different way.
Yeah, that's possible. And in that case, you have to configure the NAV server for NAV user password. Then it can combine NAV user password and access control service, which is basically used for the Azure authentication. And then users can still log in with NAV user password. The only thing is they have to use a different configuration locally.
So you have two administration.
Exactly.
Yeah. And the note was to the properties I tried on in our on-premise SharePoint.
Mm-hmm.
And you can do it dynamically.
You can do it dynamically,
yeah.
But this is a SharePoint. What you have is an on-premise SharePoint.
On-premise SharePoint.
This
I think
is SharePoint
it's
online.
The same. It looks same.
Okay, thank you.
My opinion.
I'll only get you one T-shirt, but you earned one, definitely. Because I read the information about it. You are skipping one person. He's sitting all the time with his hands high. So he on this corner. No problem. I only read the information about it. I didn't try it myself because I was running out of time. So I was repeating what I've read about it. But okay. I will try it, and if it's you are true, I'll probably blog about it. Thanks. Your question.
If I have a web client add-in inside my list page, like a drag and drop add-in, is it also available in the SharePoint then?
I guess so. Probably not, because if you are using the drag drop thing that, for example, Vyacheslav has created, that thing sits in the fact boxes. I mean, removing the fact boxes from the from the web client.
Currently, you removed it, but we are not forced to. If I leave the parameter show UI parts, it should.
Exactly. So in that way, we can edit, and then I expect that it will become possible to use this JavaScript add-in. And if you have a JavaScript add-in, you're not in the fact box, but just on the page, then I expect it will become available. Yes.
and with a default width here coming from HTML, can I work with percentage here? Let's say width is always 100%. Will it work?
I don't know. Haven't tried it. Even didn't thought about it with percentage. I don't think so, because well, in CSS you can do something with percentages, but probably this should add to the SharePoint part. So I'm not sure if it can work with percentages. But try it out. You now know how to do this, and I would love to see the results. Was there any other question? Over there? Over there? I have two t-shirts left.
I have a question about the versioning. Is it really mandatory to remove the web part, and is it not simply do you not have the possibility to reinstall the new version and mm-hmm. the SharePoint environment is picking up the new changes?
Yeah. I had the same question and I tried it, but Opportunity did not accept only a new version. I had to uninstall it before I could upload and use the next version. Yeah. Yeah. I couldn't help. I would love it if it's possible to just upload a new version and then it automatically recognizes it. That it becomes a new part available. But no, it didn't work. But I tried out that one. At least I tried out some things. Yes.
Can we use in the same manner any actions or possibly merge ribbon, or I know that we can show ribbon, but without showing ribbon, using any actions from SharePoint, like accept something or approve something?
I assume that this is possible because it's just a web client that is running, like the card page that popped up on the site. So the same way you can use reports, it will pop up with the web client behind. But it would be a good idea to try this out. Yes.
I've tried that, putting the action ribbon on the web part. It mm-hmm. doesn't come work on that. But you can open the web client from the web part,
yeah.
and then from there you can work it.
You can do this. Yeah.
Yeah, and
that's correct.
This add-ins yeah. also comes on the web part, if
yeah.
it is on the field level,
yeah.
not on the separate.
The thing is, we should not try to embed the web client completely in SharePoint, because then we are rebuilding the web client in SharePoint. Doesn't make sense. It's about having information and not about embedding the web client in SharePoint so we can do all the processes in SharePoint. Because SharePoint is a heavy site, and I don't consider SharePoint as the site to enter data and to do your daily processes. You should do this in the web client itself or in a Windows client. SharePoint is about information and not entering data. No, the SharePoint client is not available because the SharePoint client has been deprecated. This is not available anymore. Any other questions? I have 6 minutes left and two t-shirts for as very good question. Or should I show the export to SharePoint from CEL code? Is that something you want to see? I've prepared that one, so I would love to fill up the last 5 minutes with this part. Let's switch environment then. The point is, if we have this thing, the customers, you can say here Microsoft Excel. And now you see it's opening on Microsoft Excel online. And this is configured using the online services setup, online document storage configuration. By the way, I don't know how many people here are from the Netherlands, but this text over here location is translated in a Dutch version as being the name of table 14 location. Obviously called the storage location where you put items. So in Dutch it's called vestiging. Well, this is the setup for SharePoint. And here we put in the location of the SharePoint site that we're going to upload data to. This one, well, in my eyes, it should be placed between these two, because here we have the repository where we put in the documents that we upload from NEV, and there we can create a folder, and I call it NEV temp here, because we are going to put in temporary files, and we have some credentials, and there can only be one setup. This is called service one by default. You can change it, of course, but it's not possible to have more setups in this thing. So be careful with the username you're using here, because any other user that is using NIV and using this export is using SharePoint with these credentials from NEV. I can't help it. It has been designed this way. So if we remove this this record, so let's delete it. And I'll go back to Microsoft Excel, you'll see the difference. Now it asks me, do you want to open Excel? And now it opens Excel on-premise. But we did it before with the setup available, it opens Excel online. And if you do exactly the same with the web client, where do I have a web client? Let's go here. And slash Dynamics Nav slash web client. Go to customers. We click on open in Excel, and it offers me to export, to download the Excel file. This will not work on a tablet, of course. So for the tablet, we need to set up this online storage configuration. We say location is Kronos Company dot SharePoint. Whoa, can I type? Yes, come. We take a folder, well, for now we name, we take Tech Days 2014. Documents, agk.fronus.company. I set a password. It must have a valid address. Was it this? Yes. Yes, I want to show to change the password and test the connection. It is validated correctly. So what happens now on SharePoint? Go to this one, kronoscompany.sharepoint.com. I go to this one, and here you see the folder NAV Tech Days. See it? And now if I go to my client, this one, cancel, and say open in Excel, it will open in Excel online. And in, where's the folder? I did have a folder. Open it again, Kronos. And in this folder, we will see the file that was just exported. This is done by using code unit 9510. No, what was it? I'm already here. Document Service Management. This code unit is doing this stuff for you. And you can use and reuse this code unit to export files to SharePoint by code. I've prepared a code unit, and this code unit just exports using an XML export to a file, and then says Document Service Management, which is this code unit, If you are configured, then save file, and then I try to open it, but that didn't work, so I'm going to slash this one out. I go back to my menu. I have put it in the menu over here, somewhere, tasks. Say export customers. I don't have any message here, but if I go back to this site, press F5, then you have here the customers file, just exported from Coda. Temporary file? So, again.
The temporary files which are created by exporting to Excel, do you have to clean them manually here on the repository?
They are also exported by this code unit.
Yeah, but if you are using the web client and you say, for instance, the customer list, like the bottom one,
mm-hmm.
Control E, and you open it in Excel Online, then it saves the file in the documents here.
Yeah.
Afterwards, does it automatically be deleted, or do
no.
you have to? So you have to keep that in mind.
You have to keep that in mind. Yes.
Okay.
It will not be deleted. I have two T-shirts left, so I consider this a good question. One final question for the T-shirt.
By manipulating the web client URL, or in a way that we looked at today, is there a way to incorporate nav data in workflows?
Can you repeat the question?
Can we incorporate nav data in workflows rather than writing a lot of code by manipulating the URL of the web client?
By manipulating the URL, and then what we're going to do?
Incorporate in workflows, SharePoint workflows.
In SharePoint workflows? I don't think so. Probably not.
If you publish a web part from Navision for SharePoint, must I take care of the Navision user rights?
Yes, it does, completely, because you're opening the web client. And the web client just, of course, respect the user credentials and user rights.
Okay.
Yes? Any other question?
You can try, but
she's very fast.
With the export you showed, just the customer list,
mm-hmm.
Therefore it's not required to have an online SharePoint, I guess. You should also be able to do this with the on-premise SharePoint, is it?
Yes, but that takes some more configuration.
Okay. And the second question is the single sign-on is not respected, it seems, because you're in the web client and you still have to, it's still using the setting you did in the online services setup. So why is it not using the single sign-on possibilities?
That's a very good question. Because it has not been designed that way. That's the only answer. But I will take this as a suggestion to Microsoft to change this setup of exporting it. You earned one. To change this, because I think that if you logged in with the document service using your already provided credentials from Office 365, then you wouldn't have to set it up apart because you already signed in to Office 365. No, this is not the case, because you entered the site. Like, there's one person from Microsoft who wants to comment on it,
yeah.
Didn't you?
Yeah. Sorry.
Thank you. So I'm Vlad. I've been working on the single sign-on part and federated authentication. And so the reason why this is not working is that the way we've designed the authentication and the federated authentication of single sign-on was using this WS Federation passive requester profile. And this one relies on the capability of the browser to redirect to and from the identity provider in order to get the security token. If we wanted to enable this scenario, we needed to use the OAuth protocol that I showed yesterday during the demonstration. And actually, we were thinking about this, but you know, as all the features, this gets into the backlog and gets prioritized along yep. with other things. So I cannot promise anything so far, but we've given lots of thought about it, that's for sure.
That's the perfect Microsoft statement, of course. They cannot, it's later, because we'll interfere with it. They cannot promise anything, I know that. The point is that currently the Windows client, when it logs into Office 365, is using the browser. It is using in the big login box, it's using the browser, and when it redirects from Office 365, it picks up, it recognizes that it's being redirected and then picks up all the tokens. And if Microsoft changes this behavior to use the Common Sense framework in .NET, then they can pick up the token and have it completely in the environment available throughout the complete Windows client. And then you can reuse this token to Office 365. Then they have to change the login type. And now they have exactly the same login type as with the web client. So I guess this is the reason.
Yeah, exactly. And actually, it's the same mechanism that we're also using for the tablet client. So everything is like.
But if you change to Common Sense framework, then it would make it become possible.
Yeah, but yeah, that's again a pretty major change. Which would require more effort. Yeah.
Okay, guys, running out of time now. So hopefully you learned something. Have fun with trying it out. And have fun with the final session. And have a safe trip to home. Thank you.